$7 billion, $10 billion. There's different estimate dollar. Biggest U.S. embassy in the world, the middle of Baghdad, the Green Zone. Already 200-plus troops sent to guard it. You've got ISIS, admittedly filled with al-Qaeda people and worse, running around chopping the Iraqi military and police heads off, murdering Christians. And then I see Fareed Zakaria on CNN endorsing it two mornings ago, saying how bad the president of Iraq is because he's with the Iranians. And then I see the prime minister, I call him president, criticizing Iran, claiming they're involved in a double deal, wanting a war. And then I see the weapons that were sent there to that region, right across the border to Syria in the last 3 years. Clearly, the blame is with the power structure. The blame is with Bush Jr. and Cheney going in there in 2003 on lies. But it continues with the same warmongering system that they've, through proxies, taken down Libya, trying to take down Syria, and are now acting like they have no idea what's going on with ISIS. But then you see the power structure in the U.S., different groups endorsing different sides, Obama making a deal with Iran. That reportedly made Saudi Arabia mad, and so Saudi Arabia has launched this rogue attack. I want to dissect it and then ask you where it's all really going, because you just broke down what happened previously and some of the history of it. Peter Van Buren, WeMeantWell.com, State Department 24-year veteran who blew the whistle. He's got his new book, Ghost of Tom Joad, who we will do an interview with him in the near future, I promise, on that book specifically. We'll talk about that some today as well, but that's on another subject. But continuing here, Peter, you've got the floor. Break down, then, more of the history, where we currently are, and who you think is really behind the ISIS invasion and where you think that's going.
Iraq right now is like a very, very large bucket of manure. You know, every time you take a handful out, all that's underneath that is more manure. Let's take a look back in history. In 2003, the Middle East was a difficult, messy, but somewhat stable situation. Saddam, for all his terrible, terrible things that he did as a dictator, was holding the disparate elements of Iraq together. Broadly, Sunnis, Shias, and Kurds, but of course within each of those groups there are many subgroups and splinter groups and people with different, very different opinions. When we went in 2003 and got rid of Saddam, a regime change very similar to the regime change that the Obama administration is now starting to bleat about with Maliki, getting him out of there. When we did that regime change in 2003, there was nothing to replace it. I was there for a big piece of that reconstruction, working for the State Department. In fact, that's the whole theme of my first book, We Meant Well, How I Helped Lose the War. And it was the whistleblowing in that book that got me run out of the State Department. We failed to reestablish either a strong central government or a basis of power that Iraq and the greater Middle East could live with. Instead, we flirted with one side or the other, particularly bouncing between the Sunnis and the Shias to see which one we were going to support. But ultimately, the bulk of American support came down behind Maliki. In 2006, we assisted him, if not appointed him, in taking over as prime minister. We watched as the bombing of the Shia mosque in Samarra triggered off the insurgency slash civil war that we're seeing continuing now. We then continue to support Maliki despite his clear ties to Iran, trading what we thought was the long-term empowerment of Iran throughout the Middle East for some short-term gains and stability that would allow us to find an exit strategy in Iraq. And if these things sound complicated, they actually are. And one of the reasons we're seeing the chaos in Iraq right now, and we're going to see it continue, there's no question about that, is because these issues are complex and are not good things to solve, or resolve perhaps is a better word, with simple answers. The United States tried those simple answers for 9 years of occupation. We spent $2 trillion. We spent $42 billion training the Iraqi army, which outdid the French recently in terms of throwing down their weapons and running away. And we sacrificed 4,500 American lives. If all of that was too simple an answer, and it was, it's very unlikely that the United States is going to be able to do anything to kind of settle this problem now. What I'd like to do is talk about why what we're going to be doing will only make things worse. But I'll stop for a moment, Alex, to see if you have a different direction you wanted me to take it.
Well, no, I mean, I totally agree with you. Just as a layman trying to research this from the outside and reporting on it for almost 20 years on air, it just seems to be a black hole that the military-industrial complex keeps stirred up. So there's people in the State Department, there's military personnel, there's even people in the CIA who genuinely want to stabilize and have a good civilization and who want to promote peace and prosperity. But at the higher levels, you've got an establishment that wants chaos and makes money off no-bid contracts. And it looks to me like they know that you know, blowing up the Golden Mosque, as Ray McGovern here said, was really a false flag to get a civil war going. We caught, in 2006, British Special Forces dressed up like Wahhabist, running around killing Shiites to sure. get it going. So at one level, it is mismanagement and funding all sides. But when you get down to brass tacks, that's what they tell people that are moral. And so to us, it looks like it's just a big screw up. I mean, isn't this really at a certain level premeditated, that there are those that are milking the chaos?
Certainly there are those who are milking the chaos. To say it's premeditated almost gives these folks more credit than they deserve. If it was premeditated, that at least is a plan, an evil, sad plan, but a plan nonetheless. My belief is certainly there are people who take advantage of chaos or who seek to get these things for their own advantage, and the defense contractors and people like Blackwater are way at the front of that list. Instead, my experience both in 24 years at the State Department and the time I was actually physically in Iraq negotiating with Sunnis and Shias was that what America did for those 9 years was chase a series of ever-changing short-term goals. The surge is a perfect example of a short-term goal. The idea was to figure out a way to put the Sunnis out of the fight, at least temporarily. And what we did is we went in and we basically paid them extraordinary amounts of money to stop fighting. At the same time, we allowed them to either settle scores amongst themselves or using U.S. Special Forces to pick off a few bad guys that they didn't like within their own ranks. All a Sunni sheikh had to do really was say, that guy over there is Al-Qaeda, and a night raid would take place, and that guy would disappear. Whether he was Al-Qaeda or somebody who owed the sheikh money or someone who had a family debt going back 200 years was irrelevant. The thing about paying protection money, as anyone who has ever watched a mafia movie knows, is that as soon as you stop paying it, the problem starts again. I sat down with a Sunni sheikh who had been paid off by the United States, who was more than happy to tell me that one of the reasons that we passed through his checkpoints, in fact, I was sitting in his living room alive, was because America had paid him to assume this new role, and he was actually fairly comfortable with the idea. But he warned me that the money was stopping. The transition to the Maliki government was also supposed to include this transition of payoffs, and that wasn't happening. And while he certainly was going to be a polite host and allow myself and my team to leave peaceably that day, he really couldn't assure us that it would go on forever. By no coincidence, about 3 weeks later, there were seven people shot in the back of the head, not too far from where this guy works. It's certainly in his area of control. And they turned out to be Shia leaders that had been rounded up somewhere and brought for execution. Anyone who says that what's happening in Iraq right now is a surprise or unpredictable or anything along those lines is a liar or a fool. I'll challenge readers to go to my blog, wementwell.com. Go take a look at my blog post from 2011, predicting all of these things very accurately. And then ask yourself the question of who's working at the State Department now? The people who made the mistakes in 2011 that brought us to today, or the people that blew the whistle on it and got kicked out?
And the answer is it's the same people that helped create the mess, correct?
Absolutely, yes. The cast of characters has not changed at all. Tom Ricks has a column where he's got a gentleman named Ali Kadiri explaining what to do next in Iraq. Kadiri was the longest continuously serving American in the Iraq war. He never left. Currently, the State Department's point man on Iraq, who's in Iraq right now, is a guy named Brett McGurk, who was the senior advisor to three or four American ambassadors and almost was ambassador to Iraq until my blog outed him for some naughty sexual escapades on the roof of the embassy that were too embarrassing even for the Senate Foreign Relations Committee to overlook. That said, they pushed him into a non-political position and he's running the show. It's the same people. It's difficult to imagine why we won't have the same results.
Expanding on that, how do you assess the ISIS folks, and where do you see this going from your expert perspective and life history? What does your gut tell you is going to happen in Iraq now, and what do you think Obama is going to, in the long term, because he's going to announce a bunch of special forces today, obviously, but do you see this escalating into Iraq number three?
A couple of good questions there. I will start with ISIS.